The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Trinity Castro, ano?
Good morning, I'm Mike Navarro.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, initial data from a major hospital in South Africa shows patients with an Omicron COVID-19 variant mainly have mild symptoms.
Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte says he was pleased with Monday's reopening of schools in Metro Manila.
House lawmakers approved a bill declaring the country's maritime zones amid rising tensions with China and the West Philippine Sea. To speak with maritime expert Jay Batong Bakal and international studies professor Renato De Castro later on the program.
And the U.S. pushes through with its diplomatic boycott of the Winter Olympics in Beijing.
Thank you for joining us. We begin with the latest on the Omicron variant. Worries over the newest coronavirus variant ease as a study by South African doctors and experts suggests the Omicron variant driving the fourth wave of infections in the country may be causing mainly mild infections. An article by the South African Medical Research Council said majority of patients in the COVID ward of a local hospital only showed mild symptoms and were not oxygen dependent. But it cautioned more research is needed before definite conclusions can be drawn. Preliminary findings by another study also showed survivors of COVID-19 may be at higher risk for reinfection with the Omicron variant and an average person's risk for a first-time infection. Based on data on nearly 2.8 million cases, researchers in South Africa said the timing of the increase in reinfections strongly suggests they are driven by the emergence of the Omicron variant.
Here at home, latest genome sequencing results show there is still no trace yet of the Omicron variant in the Philippines. But there are still 8 travelers from South Africa who are unaccounted for. The health department also waiting for the sequencing results of a COVID-positive South African traveler and some returning overseas Filipinos.
Hopefully by Wednesday morning, makuha natin agad ang mga resulta nito. Kasama nito yung sa South African na nagpositibo. As to the contacts na sinasabi nung sa South African na i-report natin na naka-quarantine, lahat po ay na may mild or either asymptomatic o di kaya ay may mild na kaso yung nagpositibo.
Despite the government's biosurveillance efforts, the DOH admits it's inevitable for the Omicron variant to find its way into the country. That's why measures have been placed to prepare the health system. President Rodrigo Duterte also confident the country can cope with the possible entry of the newest COVID variant.
We are not hoping for the best, but we pray to God that it will not come to our shores. But if ever, if the thing na we can cope up with it just as we did with COVID-19.
The Philippines logged 543 new COVID infections Monday, the 8th straight day that the number of cases has remained below 700. 113 deaths were also reported. Active cases stand at 13,548. The lowest since May 31 of last year. At this point, the health department says the country is now at minimal risk for COVID-19. It notes only the regions of Cagayan Valley, Mimaropa, and the Zamboanga Peninsula have a positivity rate of more than 5%, but they are steadily declining. The national health system capacity also at low risk.
All regions show decrease in average daily attack rates compared to the previous 3 to 4 weeks and remain to be at minimal to low risk case classification with a negative 1 or 2 week growth rates. All regions have a total COVID-19 bed and ICU utilization at low risk or less than 50%. The National Capital Region is currently at low risk case classification.
President Duterte says he was pleased with the cautious reopening of schools in Metro Manila. Over 2 dozen public schools in the capital region resumed in-person classes Monday after nearly 2 years of distance learning. The Education Department also reported that everything went smoothly despite the additional health protocols required.
Sana hindi magbago itong pag-trend ng ating pag-monitor. It's been very positive and we are anticipating a recommendation towards expansion.
I'm glad that they have thought of this just dahan-dahan lang. Huwag siya wasang masyadong mabilis kasi just the better part of prudence.
Today, 277 public schools and 20 private schools have been allowed to conduct pilot face-to-face classes. President Duterte asking other schools to be patient while government works on further expanding the pilot program.
Do not be dismayed kung hindi sa inyo muna, because these are all experimental and pilot projects. Doon muna titignan natin kasi nandoon lahat yung resources ng government and yung mga official nandoon at makita kaagad at they can keep posted on what is happening.
That's the new population target coverage of the Philippine government's COVID vaccination drive. The initial target was 70% of the country's population. Authorities raised it due to the threat of the Omicron variant. But ABS-CBN data analytics head Edson Guido believes this is a tall order, citing the logistical problems hounding the COVID vaccination campaign.
At our current pace, we would be able to reach 70% of the population by the first quarter of 2022, which is the target, also the revised target of the government right now. We have ample supply. As of latest data, we have 146 million total doses that have arrived in the country. But the problem really is the administration of vaccines, because if you have 146 million available, 146 million total, and you have just administered around 91 million total, then you have around more 55 million doses available. So the challenge really is not the supply right now. We have more than enough supply.
Officials of the Philippine League of Provinces also not optimistic. The group says a shortage of vaccinators led to missed vaccination targets in the provinces. President Duterte says 10.2 million COVID jabs were given during the government's 5-day mass vaccination drive last week.
The Philippines receives more COVID-19 vaccines. Over 1 million doses of government-procured Pfizer shots arrived in Manila on a Monday evening, bringing the total number of jabs that have arrived in the country to more than 149 million. The latest shipment comes ahead of another massive inoculation drive on December 15 to 17. Over 38.1 million Filipinos have so far been fully vaccinated against COVID-19.
The Philippine National Police eyeing the removal of unvaccinated policemen from field duty. PNP Chief Gennardo Carlos says they will come out with a memorandum circular for the so-called no jab, no duty policy in the coming days. But Carlos clarified vaccinated police officers will only be reassigned to administrative duties and not get kicked out of the force.
The soonest that we crafted that policy, then we will implement it. Kasi directed kami ng IATF. Number one, why are we not going to deploy them? Because we do not want to put them at risk.
According to the PNP, nearly 2,000 cops have yet to get their COVID jabs. That's less than 1% of the entire police force.
Speaking of vaccine policies, New York City is expanding its vaccine mandate to include all private sector employees and children over 5 years old. Details in this report.
And we have to move quickly. And that's why I describe the actions we're taking today as a preemptive strike. Get ahead of this problem before it deepens and use the thing that works, vaccination.
As the holidays and colder weather collide with the highly transmissible Omicron variants, New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio is doubling down on the fight against COVID-19. The mayor announcing Monday that starting December 27th, all private sector employers must ensure their workers have been fully vaccinated. The mandate, de Blasio said, is the first of its kind in the nation.
It is time. Look, this is how we put health and safety first. By ensuring that there is a vaccine mandate that reaches everyone universally in the private sector.
In addition, children 5 to 11 years old must get at least one vaccine dose by December 14th to enter restaurants and to participate in extracurricular school activities such as sports, band, orchestra, and dance.
Only one dose required. There's time for parents to get that done.
Patrons over the age of 12 must also be fully vaccinated in order to enter businesses after December 27th. The requirements come at a time when new coronavirus infections are accelerating nationwide, especially in northern states, and as the highly transmissible Omicron variant has spread to at least one-third of U.S. states.
In other news, China's influence in the Indo-Pacific region wanes as the UN gains ground. That's according to the latest Asia Power Index of Sydney, a Sydney-based think tank, Lowy Institute. The index showed China fell to second place after losing 1.5 points in its overall score. The index is based on 8 categories, including military capability, economic resources, and diplomatic influence. The US, on the other hand, topped 6 of the 8 measures, registering its first annual gain in comprehensive power since the Institute began publishing the index in 2018. The index also showed almost all countries lost power amid the COVID pandemic in terms of their capacity to respond to and shape the external environment. But the U.S. was a rare exception. As for the Philippines, it's at the middle of the list, the country's overall score contracting 0.2 points. The country performed best in the defense networks measure, but ranked low, 20th place in the resilience measure, which the study said reflected poor levels of internal stability.
Philippine House lawmakers approve a bill declaring the country's maritime zones amid rising tensions with China in the West Philippine Sea. The measure aims to establish the legal basis by which social, economic, commercial, and other activities may be connected in these zones. House Committee on Foreign Affairs Chair Ann Hofer says the approval marks an important step towards consolidating the country's maritime jurisdiction as declared in the 2016 Arbitral Award. The bill is now headed to the Senate. Just recently, tensions between the country and China flared up again after a Chinese patrol ship chased off a Philippine Navy vessel resupplying forces stationed at the Yunnan Shoal.
To talk more about these developments, we are joined by Professor Jay Batumbaka, the director of the UP Institute for Maritime Affairs and Law of the Sea. Also with us this morning is Professor Renato De Castro, distinguished professor in the International Studies Department at the convener of national security at the Albert del Rosario Institute. Professors, good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Mike. Morning.
How are you doing? Yeah.
All right. Great. Great to have you this morning, Professors De Castro and Professor Batumbaka. Let me just begin with you. How significant is it that we should have a law defining the maritime jurisdictions under the country? These are these not actually defined already by the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea?
Well, yes, they are defined in the Law of the Sea Convention, but in terms of implementation, we do have a problem because our laws are rather old, no, when it comes to the maritime zones. We had a baselines law which was enacted in 2009 that only provided the starting point. You still have to measure all of the maritime zones in accordance with UNCLOS. And our existing laws, some of them are not in conformity with UNCLOS. So this bill really is necessary.
And Professor Batumbakal, Representative Ann Hofer, the principal author of the bill, said the maritime bill will consolidate our maritime jurisdiction. It will improve maritime governance and law enforcement and will provide the legal basis by which social, economic, commercial, and other activities will be conducted. Explain to us how this will happen, given that if you look at the law, it just really actually defines what are the maritime jurisdictions in the Philippines.
Yes, well, one thing it does really is to clarify, no, with respect to the maritime zones of the Philippines, it clarifies whether we are claiming these zones in accordance with international law or not. Because our previous laws, there have been a number of inconsistencies in the way that we were claiming maritime zones around the archipelago and around the Calayan Island group. So this bill, this new law, will then make it certain, no? It will really clarify to the world that we are claiming them in accordance with UNCLOS, particularly the zones being, well, reaching up to 12 nautical miles for the territorial sea, 200 nautical miles for the EEZ continental shelf, and also declaring a contiguous zone. No? So that is very clear now. No? We don't have any more problems with old legislation claiming arbitrary zones around the Philippines. Second, it also establishes very clearly in the law what are the permissible and impermissible actions that vessels may take while traversing these maritime zones. No? That is very important, especially for our law enforcers, no? And the Navy, Coast Guard, Maritime Police, because before there would always be questions as to whether or not something can or cannot be done in a particular area of the Philippines in the seas because of the inconsistencies between the old law and international law. So this will now clarify that as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me go to Professor De Castro and I'll pose the same question, Professor De Castro. The bill merely defines maritime jurisdiction. So how will it enhance maritime governance and law enforcement, especially when dealing with Chinese intrusions in areas over which the Philippines has sovereignty or sovereign rights?
Well, I haven't seen the law and I have to emphasize, I'm not a lawyer. Mm-hmm. So I cannot really comment on the basic essence. You have to refer to Jay. I can basically talk in terms of the international politics strategic dimension, but for one thing, I haven't seen the law and I'm not really in a position to talk about the legal merits of that law.
Mm-hmm. But do you think, sir, from an international studies perspective, having a domestic law that defines the maritime jurisdictions, will it enhance our, say, enforcement of those maritime jurisdictions when dealing with a foreign power?
The enforcement is another matter. Mm-hmm. Professor Batumbakal talked about the Navy, the Coast Guard, other law enforcement agencies. So you need to back up that law, of course, with capabilities, like what China is doing. You know, China is although China's claim has no basis under international law, based on the ruling, and Professor Batumbakal is very much aware of it, China backs its claim through the enforcement. So this is where China uses what you call power politics, real politics. In our case, at this point in time, we're relying on law. But the great challenge for us is we have to back this law with, of course, capabilities. Mm-hmm. So in the end, of course, when you talk about the international system, this is where you have basically what President Duterte said. The strong basically do what they have to do. The weak would have to accept their fate. Hopefully, law could make a difference.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Professor, there's also a pending measure to amend the Philippine Archipelagic Baselines Law. And I recall you told us on this program a few months ago that there is no need to pass a new baselines law and the existing RA9522 is already enough. You said a presidential proclamation would suffice. Now, how would this bill on maritime jurisdictions be different from that of the baselines law?
Well, these are two different things. No? The baselines law is about the starting point for measuring these maritime zones, while the Maritime Zone Act is the actual implementation of that action of measuring, declaring, measuring these maritime zones and clearly laying out what can or cannot be done in them. So these two can actually proceed separately.
Mm-hmm. And do you still maintain the view, sir, that the RA9522 suffices for now, at least in terms of defining archipelagic baselines?
Yes, actually, it's already an existing law, and the baselines are already there, and all it needs now is executive implementation. The new Maritime Zone Act will now fully reinforce the implementation by the executive through the mapping and also through the law enforcement afterwards. So there's really not much else that needs to be done. And in fact, by going ahead with executive implementation, that is clear proof, that is clear evidence that we are fully exercising our sovereignty and jurisdiction over all of these maritime zones.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me go back to Professor De Castro. How will a new law establishing Philippine maritime jurisdictions, assuming that this bill does become a law, affect our relationships with our coastal neighbors, China in particular? Because I recall when China amended its maritime law to require foreign vessels sailing in the South China Sea to report information to Chinese authorities, the Philippines said Manila will ignore it. So won't our maritime law suffer the same fate?
Yeah, of course, especially if it's not backed up by naval and law enforcement capabilities. When China declared that law this year, that directive, remember China first also passed a law empowering its Coast Guard earlier, the new Chinese Coast Guard law. And before China passed that law, China has already developed its Coast Guard capabilities. Now, since, of course, when it formed the Chinese Coast Guard in 2013, then basically also equipped it with formal naval vessels from the People's Liberation Army's Navy. And in 2018, it put the Chinese Coast Guard under, of course, the People's Police, this paramilitary group that's under directly the military commission. So what China is doing, before it passes a law, it basically creates what we call the military and law enforcement capability to back up that law. Law by itself, when you talk about international relations, is simply a piece of paper, unless you back it, of course, with the naval capability and law enforcement capabilities. And that is what China's been doing. So I basically agree that we have to pass this law, but at the same time, we also have to develop our naval and law enforcement capabilities. Because in the end, if it's we pass that law without those necessary requirements, it will just be, as mentioned no less by President Duterte about the arbitral ruling, it will just be a piece of paper.
Mm-hmm. Professor Batumbacal, do you agree? On the other hand, while we do need to enforce this by backing up with enforcement, but won't this also provoke China to react?
Well, China always reacts whatever we do. So the fact that they may do so with this law should not deter us, no? After all, by enacting this law, we are only implementing our rights and obligations under international law. So, in fact, any opposition on the part of China with respect to the exercise of these rights and obligations puts it in a rather bad light, no? Because they're trying to prevent us from carrying out our obligations and commitments under international law. They would probably react only because the law implicitly will also be applicable to these territories that they also claim. But, you know, that has always been the case anyway. So it will not be that much different from before. No, I mean, the situation will not be very different. No, we will all still be claiming these jurisdictions, these territories. We'll all still be trying to enforce our respective laws and regulations. But at least on our part, no, we will be much more certain that we are acting in accordance with international law, while they may not be.
Mm-hmm. Professor De Castro, the question really is, as you pointed out, how do we enforce this? China is already not recognizing the 2016 arbitral ruling.
Well, of course, the rule there is you build up your muscle. Specifically, of course, I'm mentioning the Navy, and of course, the law enforcement agencies. Then next in line will be the Philippine Coast Guard. So we have to put, you know, the money where our mouth is. That's basically what is necessary. And especially, this will be a very important task for the next administration. You know, to adopt a policy that would, of course, put muscle into the law, this maritime law we're passing right now. So that's a key challenge. So it also would entail restructuring our defense capabilities, focusing, of course, in our maritime domain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Professor Batumbakal, your thoughts on this and enforcing this, and do you see any prospect within this administration still to, you know, try to enforce this and back this maritime law?
Yes, well, for small countries like us, there are two things we can do in addition to trying to back up our own muscle, no, or beef up our own muscle. One is we, of course, will always rely on international law because it is through international law that power can be equalized. No? And that's why we must always dedicate ourselves to creating an international community which works under the rule of law instead of the rule of the jungle. So that is one important advocacy we must always insist on. Second is, since we are a small country and we will never be able to match the power of a country that's 10 times our size in terms of economy and population, what we need to do is to cultivate alliances and friendships with other countries who also are invested in an international community that works by the rule of law. So that includes ASEAN members as well as external countries like Japan, who hold the law very highly and who believe that even states must work in accordance with international law. So with those two added to the beefing up of our own muscle, that will allow us, no, the strength, no, give us the strength to try to push harder on protecting our interests and eventually seek the enforcement and recognition of the arbitral award and its contents.
Mm-hmm. Professor De Castro, let me shift gears now to this assessment by Australian think tank Lowy Institute. So in its yearly Asia Power Index, it says China's influence in the Indo-Pacific region is waning, though still at number two. In contrast, the United States maintained its position as the most influential, even overtaking China in areas like future resources and diplomatic influence. Do you agree with this assessment?
Well, I take it with a grain of salt. You know, I've been doing it for about since 2018. So it's just like watching a boxing match. Round one, round two, round three. So in the past 4 years, especially last year, I've been using this in my class, in my foreign policy analysis class. Last year, the U.S. declined. Mm-hmm. This was, of course, during the Trump administration. So now it increased, and you have to look at the index. So you have to take it with, in a way, a grain of salt. It will be useful in terms of analyzing power dynamics in the region. It will be used for academic discussion, but you cannot simply rely on this in terms of policy. You know, just it could not be, as a term used in the intelligence community, it will not be an actionable analysis. Now, having said that, what is basically the essence of this? Now, you look at, again, the index, the United States ranked very high when it comes to defense diplomacy. This is only logical because the United States relies on alliances, and under the Biden administration, the Biden administration had put emphasis on building up alliances and, of course, recently, minilaterals. The most important example, of course, will be AUKUS. You know, Britain, Australia, and the United States, and, of course, also strengthening the Quad, Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, and, of course, also boosting its alliances. So last July, upon, of course, after meeting U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin, President Duterte decided to put the BFA on track. And, of course, just a few weeks ago, we signed a joint vision with the United States regarding the alliance. So this is something normal for the United States because the United States relies on these minilaterals and alliances. China couldn't care less. Mm-hmm. It's a policy of China not to rely on alliances, although it had an alignment with Russia. So it's only natural for, you know, the index to increase because the United States gives importance to alliances, minilaterals. That's why you have this dramatic increase in terms of defense diplomacy. But of course, for the Chinese, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm. Professor De Castro, what a difference a change in administration makes in terms of the U.S. is maintaining its global superpower status. I mean, are you seeing a lot of differences in the way Trump handled this situation prior to Joe Biden's assumption.
I think it's really more in terms of the messaging. No, but if you look at the nitty-gritty of their policy, there's been, of course, continuity. There's a bipartisan element. For one thing, the Biden administration decided that it will continue its strategic competition with China. They even praised the Trump administration for, you know, initiating this competition with China. What the Biden administration said was, we're going to improve this competition. We'll make it across the board, including technology, and we will make our, you know, we will basically strengthen our position by relying on alliances and security partnerships. So that's, I think, the key difference in contrast to what had been perceived as a unilateral approach of the Trump administration. But of course, still, this administration has been criticized after the withdrawal from Afghanistan by its own allies. So this is, of course, a key challenge. You know, everything is happening, of course, given the, you know, current developments right now. You know, this might be your policy, but you have to take into account previous policies of the previous administration.
Mm-hmm. Professor DiCasso, of particular interest is the U.S.'s so-called vaccine diplomacy. How was the U.S. able to do this, considering that China has mass-produced Sinovac, and in fact, it has donated millions of doses to its neighbors in other countries?
Simple. The United States produced better vaccines. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Up to the line. Plus, of course, you cannot simply underestimate the industrial capacity of the United States. China produced two vaccines. Of course, the quality are questionable. The United States produced three vaccines, Pfizer, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson. No one has ever questioned the efficacy and the safety of these vaccines.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me go to Professor Batong Bakal. What would be the impact of the U.S. maintaining its influence in the Indo-Pacific region in terms of maritime disputes? We have a mutual defense treaty with the U.S. We also have other agreements. Will their continued influence in the region be advantageous to us?
Well, of course, it will be advantageous to us because the U.S. Is invested as well in the international legal system, which includes the UNCLOS. It is what guarantees that not only the U.S., but all countries are able to exercise what we call the freedom of the seas. And that is important for us to be able to maintain access to these resources and to be able to maintain our jurisdictions. The fact that they have been able to bounce back despite the slump under Trump also is an indication that the countries around the region are also welcoming the return, quote-unquote, of the U.S. To prominence, because they do know that it is with the international legal system that the U.S. Supported. It is true that they will be able to protect their own interests against a growing power like China.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for your thoughts this morning, Professor J. Batong Bakal and Professor Renato DiCastro.
Thank you very much. Have a pleasant day.
Thank you. Welcome.
In other news, a lawyer releases a copy of the graft complaint filed against Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and Davao businessman Dennis Uy over the controversial Malampaya deal. Rico Domingo, the lawyer of complainants, showed the copy dated October 18. This means the complaint against Cusi and Uy were filed prior to the publication of media reports refuting claims of Cusi and Uy's lawyer that there was no complaint at the time the reports were published. Cusi and Uy filed cyber libel cases against several news organizations, including ABS-CBN, the parent firm of this news channel, over what they call malicious reporting on the Malampaya deals.
Kung ang kanilang nire-report lamang ay tunay na sinabi sa criminal complaint at wala nang iba, they're not editorializing, and it is a pure reportorial of what had been alleged and averred in the criminal complaint, then walang problema ang journalist. Under the law, dapat may prior approval ng DOE at dapat may due diligence on the financial, legal, and the technical qualifications of the transferee or the assignee. They did not do that.
Meanwhile, journalist groups insist that regardless of when the formal graft complaint against Cusi and Uy was filed, there was still nothing libelous in the stories written about them.
most of them, at least the ones that I was able to read, were just straight news stories. There was absolutely no basis on the part of Mr. Cusi to say that he has been maligned, unduly maligned, by the articles.
At the time of the reporting, whether there was a formal complaint or none is beside the point. This is a matter of public interest and therefore a matter for media reporting and commentary. And the media were not quoting any ghost sources, quoting people who were prepared to come forward and pursue their allegations. And the media went to the other side and asked for it. So what's anomalous about the whole thing?
The two also believe this latest libel suit will spur journalists to be more tenacious in doing their job.
If Mr. Cusi thinks that there will be less reports about him with his decision to file criminal libel charges against journalists, he's mistaken. Oh, mas lalo niyang kuan eh, mas lalo niyang ginatungan yung issue.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, Manila Mayor and presidential hopeful Escol Moreno endorses the senatorial bid of President Duterte.
And the U.S. pushes through with its diplomatic boycott of the Winter Olympics in Beijing. These and more when the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web, Inquirer's banner story online, Philippines has improved rankings in the Global COVID-19 Recovery Index. Philippine Star's top story, the Philippine poll body warning political candidates about scams and rigging election results. Manila Bulletin's headline, the Education Department eyeing further expansion of the implementation of face-to-face classes. Topping GMA News' website, the Philippines now enjoying a substantial level of immunity to COVID-19. And CNN Philippines' banner story, the latest pandemic figures.
Manila Mayor and Presidential Hopeful Francisco is the senatorial bid of President Rodrigo Duterte. Moreno spoke in Cebu, where he described Duterte as a highly qualified candidate whom he can adopt in his Senate slate. Duterte once made veiled attacks on Moreno when he criticized the skimpily clad photos of an unnamed local chief executive. Moreno's sexy photos during his former acting career had previously circulated online.
I'm going to vote for him personally, and I'm going to endorse him, hopefully, kung papayag siya, I'll be honored. I'll be humbled and honored na umuwi si Pangulong Duterte.
A political analyst, meanwhile, isn't sure if getting Duterte's endorsement would be good for Isko.
Indeed, Marcos is at the front. And then Isko and Lenny are slugging it out for the second, but a far distant second and third. So they have to do something to increase their numbers. Probably it's also a sign of desperation. So the assumption is that because Duterte has a loyal base, then therefore if Isko gets the endorsement of President Duterte, that all the supporters of Duterte will move to him. But that is my problem. When you have that kind of analysis and that kind of perspective, you're thinking of the voters as if they're going to act automatically or mechanically or in a predictable way. And I say I think voters don't do that anymore.
Moreno only has three candidates in his Aksyon Demokratiko senatorial ticket. Mindanao civic leader Samir Aguto, Quezon City Councilor Jopet Sison, and Carl Balita, an entrepreneur and health professional.
Vice President Lenny Robredo takes a swipe at Mayor Isko Moreno's move to support the Senate bid of President Duterte. Robredo says she respects Moreno's decision, but she notes it says something about his goals and principles.
Karapatan niya naman yun. Karapatan naman piliin kung sino yung gusto mong makasama. Pero yung choices naman, not just for this bid, pero yung choices naman natin lahat, laging reflection siya ng aspirations natin. Lagi siyang reflection ng values na pinapaniwalaan natin.
Robredo adds she is proud of her 12-person senatorial lineup, which includes people she has worked with in many of her advocacies.
The Commission on Elections set to raffle off party list placements in the ballots this week. This after the COMELEC denied over 100 groups applying for accreditation. These include organizations seeking to represent Pinerson, the LGBTQ community, and the transport sector. Some of them held rallies Monday to protest this, but the full body stands by its decision.
Mga na-deny, as I said before, for the most part, failure to comply with some of the requirements. For example, if you are applying to become a sectoral party, you must show that your members are at least a majority of your members are part of that sector that you're representing. Okay? Remember, this is a different rule from if you're applying to be a political party lamang.
Hindi raw po namin sapat na patunayan na ang aming mga officers at members ng Nurses United Party List ay mga nurses. Hindi totoo na hindi namin napatunayan sapagkat lahat ng aming dokumento na isinumite ay nagsasaad na ang aming mga kasapian, ang aming mga officers ay lehitimong mga nurses.
In business, the Communist Party of China lays down its economic priorities for next year. Top leaders called for actions that would safeguard China's macroeconomic stability, proactive fiscal policies and prudent monetary policies. They also stressed the importance of the solid implementation of China's domestic demand expansion strategy. The leaders also noted micro policies should stimulate the vitality of market entities and the protection of intellectual property rights. This framework comes as advisors to China's government recently recommended a softer growth target for next year of as low as 5% amid growing headwinds from a property downturn, weakening exports, and strict COVID-19 curbs.
The Philippine House of Representatives passes a bill requiring the registration of SIM cards. Under the measure, a SIM card user must present a valid or government-issued ID with photos to confirm his or her identity. Failure to comply will be a ground for the seller or the telco to refuse the sale of the SIM card. Information submitted by the SIM user is subject to the bill's confidentiality clause. More than 180 lawmakers voted to pass the measure, while six rejected it, including Bayan Muna Representative Carlos Zarate, who said it violates the rights to privacy of Filipinos. A similar measure is pending before the Senate.
Hindi natin linilimitahan dito yung number of prepaid. Kahit bumili ka ng 20, 30, 40, basta i-register mo sa pangalan mo yun. Ang importante kasi ngayon, natatrack down to eh. Ngayon, kasi ngayon, hindi siya natatraktod. Mayroon tayong isang komisyon na walang ginawa kundi bantayan ating privacy. Meaning, kung sino kumuha ng information natin, dapat protektahan yan. At mabigat ang penalty at parusa kung yung organisasyon na yun ay hindi protektahan yung ating information.
A look now at the financial markets. Wall Street began the week on a strong note as investors shrug off fears over the Omicron variant. The Dow rallied 1.8% as shares linked to economic reopening advance. The S&P 500 and the tech-heavy Nasdaq also climbed out of negative territory. Over in Europe, stocks also closed higher amid easing concerns about the Omicron variant. But it was a mixed picture here in Asia, with Hong Kong's Hang Seng Index dropping 1.7% Monday, dragged by tech shares. The PSEI meanwhile climbed 1% to 71.30 as the local bourse have returned to pre-pandemic trading hours.
Now here are some economic data releases we're monitoring this Tuesday. The Philippines will post its November inflation print. The inflation rate in the Philippines declined to a three-month low of 4.6% in October due to a slowdown in prices of food and non-alcoholic beverages. The Philippines will also come out with its October jobs data. The unemployment rate in the Philippines rose to an eight-month high of 8.9% in September following the reimposition of strict lockdown measures in August. And the Reserve Bank of Australia will announce its last policy decision for the year. The central bank is expected to hold its fire once again and keep the current policy on hold after abandoning the yield curve control in November.
The four-year jail sentence of Nobel Peace Prize winner Aung San Suu Kyi is reduced to two following a partial pardon from Myanmar's military chief. More in this report.
A Myanmar court has sentenced Aung San Suu Kyi to 4 years in jail. The deposed leader was charged with incitement and breaching COVID-19 restrictions, according to a source. President Win Myint was handed the same sentence. Critics are dismissing the case as a farce. Amnesty International said the charges against Suu Kyi were bogus and described the jail sentence as the latest example of the military's determination to eliminate all opposition. The two leaders have been detained since the February military coup. The country has been in turmoil since then, paralysed by protests and a deadly crackdown on the junta's opponents. Suu Kyi faces a dozen court cases that include charges of corruption and violating state secrets. The maximum sentences would mean more than 100 years in prison combined. Suu Kyi's supporters say the legal trouble is aimed at ending her political career while the military consolidates power. The military, however, has previously said that Suu Kyi is being given due process in an independent court, led by a judge appointed by her own administration. The trial has been closed to the media, and her lawyers have been barred from communicating with the media and public. The military has not disclosed where Suu Kyi is being detained.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now with our Bureau Chief, TJ Manoto.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here's the latest stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community. Let's begin with four U.S.-based administrators of the Philippine megachurch Kingdom of Jesus Christ virtually facing a Los Angeles federal judge. Three Southern California-based defendants, Guia Cabactulan, Amanda Estopare, and Marisa Duenas, all entered not guilty pleas to a superseding indictment that accuses them of playing roles in a sex and labor trafficking and immigration fraud involving Pastor Apollo Kibuloy. The fourth defendant, Felina Salinas, checked in from Hawaii and pleaded not guilty as well. There's still no timetable on if and when Kibuloy will be brought to the U.S. to face the charges.
One of the things that's for certain is if he comes to the from the Philippines, he will not be allowed to return to his church and his congregation worldwide until his case is over, which could take an awfully long time. So there is a legal process, and they have a law firm in the Philippines that is handling that process.
Meanwhile, New York-born and raised Philam Daniel Corpus is among the eight top pastry chefs and chocolate professionals who competed in a new reality series on Netflix called School of Chocolate, where host, world-renowned chocolatier Amari Gichion, mentors his class of eight to create mouth-watering and mind-blowing edible chocolate showpieces. The student crowned best in class takes home $50,000 and the honor of teaching a masterclass at the Pastry Academy Las Vegas, where Gichion teaches.
Proud ako talaga na this, you know, parents ko from the Philippines, right? From the Philippines. Dito ako pinanak, pero, you know, clearly nakakatagalog pa ako, right? Yun yung una, that was the first thing that my parents taught me, pero I wanted to represent in one way or another, diba? Flavor-wise or design-wise.
And finally, we head to San Francisco, where the city teamed up with the Filipino Cultural District to host a Christmas block party featuring carolers, karaoke, and Filipino food.
It's a very historic area, and there's always been Filipino families that have lived in these alleys in South Market for over 100 years, so it's really important for us to celebrate.
Music came from the karaoke machine, which is built into the TNT Tricycle, a mobile art project. The party also featured other treats.
We have free hot chocolate, cider, we got suman from Tita Rosie's.
The event was capped off with carolers arriving in one of the world-famous trolley cars. And those are the latest headlines from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, TJ. The U.S. announces a diplomatic boycott of the 2022 Beijing Olympics. This means Washington will not send any diplomatic or official representation to the event. President Joe Biden was already mulling the move since last month in protest of China's human rights record, including what he described as the genocide against minority Muslims in the western region of Xinjiang.
But this is just sending a message that, given these human rights abuses, we cannot proceed with business as usual.
China's Washington embassy, meanwhile, dismissed America's diplomatic boycott as a pretentious act that would have no impact on the holding of the Games. Beijing also reiterating that no invitation has been extended to U.S. politicians for the event.
And let's now talk to Ms. Karen Davila for today's guests on Head Start. Morning, Ms. Karen.
Hello, good morning, Katie and Mike. Hello, how
are you both? It's
been a while. It's been a while, exactly.
I have to say, and I'm quite impressed that Mike is doing rundown from another country in another time zone.
Mm-hmm. And yet, yeah, his background is still on, as far with us, right?
Yes, I agree. Well, today we have
part of the job.
Today we have Senator Richard Gordon. So we will be talking about his senatorial re-election plans. And more than that, there have been 14 hearings with Farmily. So we'll find out what is the outcome of these hearings. What can we expect as taxpayers from these hearings? How can these hearings actually change the way purchasing procurement is done in government? And what kind of justice, if needed, will the Filipino people get from these hearings?
And, you know, what has happened to the petitions against the Senate Farmily probe pending with the Supreme Court? And the Senate, too, has actually petitioned against the president's order for cabinet members not to attend hearings.
Yes, definitely.
All right. We'll watch out for that. Thank you, Ms. Karen Davila. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navallo. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.